Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Origins of the Urban Crisis, Race and Inequality in Postwar Detroit, by Thomas J. Sugrue. Narrated by Adam Lofbomm. Publisher's Note: This audiobook refers to figures and tables included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Preface to the Princeton Classics Edition. On July 17, 2013, the city of Detroit filed for bankruptcy in federal court. It was a catastrophe long in coming, the result of decades of disinvestment, depopulation, political marginalization, and financial mismanagement from the city-county building to Lansing to Wall Street. The first decade of the 21st century was particularly hard on Detroit. The international financial crisis devastated the city. General Motors and Chrysler saw their market share collapse, and in December 2009, went to the federal government with a request for billions in loans. In every sector of the economy, jobless rates skyrocketed. Using the most conservative estimates, Detroit's unemployment peaked at 24.9% in 2009 and fell only to 16.3% in mid-2013. The median household income in the city was only $27,862. A staggering 36.2% of Detroit's population was living beneath the official poverty line. John Zimek, president of United Automobile Workers, UAW Local 174, once led by labor giant Walter Reuther, lamented that the middle class really is going away, and I don't have the answer for it. Compounding the city's economic woes, the mortgage and foreclosure crisis hit Detroiters especially hard. In 2007, just at the onset of the economic collapse, 62% of all subprime loans in the Detroit area went to African Americans. When the national home finance market collapsed in 2008, properties in Detroit plummeted in value. Many homeowners were stuck with mortgage payments that exceeded their property values. Lenders foreclosed on properties, and some homeowners simply left their homes when they could not meet monthly payments. By 2011, there were more than 90 foreclosed properties per square mile in Detroit. The economic and housing market collapse accelerated Detroit's population loss. Between 2000 and 2010, Detroit lost a remarkable 25% of its population. Depopulation and housing abandonment scarred the city's landscape. In 2013, somewhere between 21 and 40 of the city's 139 square miles were empty. The exact figure is a matter of debate, and at least 90,000 properties were vacant. Scarcely a block in Detroit, even in the healthiest neighborhoods, did not have at least one abandoned house. The decline in population has gutted the fabric of many already struggling neighborhoods, leaving shuttered stores, churches, restaurants, bars, and even libraries, police stations, and schools behind. Those who have remained within the city's boundaries are overwhelmingly working class and poor, mostly African American. 82.2% of the city's 717,000 residents in 2010 census. The long process of white flight that began in the 1950s is now nearly complete. Only 7.8% of Detroiters are white. The remaining residents are mostly Latino or mixed race, with Mexican Americans about 33,000 strong, the largest ethnic group, most of them concentrated in neighborhoods southwest of downtown. A few years ago, The Onion ran a headline: Detroit sold for scrap. Like many stories in that satirical newspaper, it was both a parody and painfully close to the truth. One of the city's few growth industries is scrapping. A few years ago, inept scavengers pulled down a large part of a pedestrian bridge at the defunct Packard plant, a mile-long complex that stopped making cars in 1957, in an effort to retrieve its steel support beams. When I visited shortly afterward, an electrical crew was replacing copper wire that had been stripped out of nearby live power lines. Drivers learned to veer around sewer openings in the streets because every time iron prices rise, sewer lids disappear, leaving car-eating holes in their place. Scavengers descend on newly abandoned houses within days, removing plumbing, wiring, and anything else that can be resold. Detroit's bankruptcy is the grim epilogue to the story that I tell in the origins of the urban crisis. But the conventional wisdom about Detroit seldom takes into account the long historical process that reshaped the city. Many observers, particularly on the right, blame unions for keeping wages and pensions high, point their fingers at Detroit's mayors, particularly Coleman Young and Kwame Kilpatrick, for corruption and misrule, or criticize the Democratic Party and liberals for failing to implement austere budgets. Columnist George Will wrote that Detroit's bankruptcy poses worrisome questions about the viability of democracy in jurisdictions where big government and its unionized employees collaborate in pillaging taxpayers. To understand Detroit's troubled fiscal situation, however, requires a long-term view. Detroit, like many cities, depends on property taxes to provide services, particularly public education. But the total value of property in the city fell by 77%, in constant dollars, in the half-century beginning in the early 1960s. The long-term flight of industry from the city had particularly negative consequences for the city's tax base, leaving contaminated, mostly unmarketable brownfields where factories once hummed. Nearly 75 years after Detroit rose as America's arsenal of democracy, car manufacturing was little more than a symbolic presence in Motor City. Motown lost more than 300,000 auto industry jobs, beginning in the late 1940s. The process of deindustrialization that I describe in The Origins of the Urban Crisis occurred steadily and relentlessly, following a path that led to the suburbs, to the rural Midwest, to the Sun Belt, to Canada and Mexico, and also overseas, as car manufacturers and suppliers searched for cheap labor, low taxes, and lax regulations. Trade policies encouraged the shift of production across American borders, and cheaply made car parts flooded the U.S. market. Just as automation in the 1950s led to a drop in auto industry employment, so too did new technologies introduced in the late 20th century shrink the manufacturing workforce further. Compounding the industry's woes was the rise of aggressive international competition, reducing the market share of the big three, Chrysler, Ford, and General Motors. The auto industry, conservative and slow to change, was also responsible for its troubles. During the economic boom of the mid and late 1990s, American car makers gambled on huge sport utility vehicles, a decision that paid off until gas prices skyrocketed during the next decade. Only one auto factory remained in Detroit in 2013, the Chrysler Jefferson North plant on the east side, part of the Poletown plant, a General Motors facility built under Mayor Coleman Young on the remains of a once-thriving, racially diverse neighborhood, straddles the border between Detroit and the separate municipality of Hamtramck. General Motors headquarters, which employs mostly white-collar and clerical workers, still remains in the city, in recently renovated riverfront offices. Together, Chrysler and General Motors employed about 8,000 in Detroit in 2013. The combination of job loss, depopulation, disinvestment, property devaluation, and commercial decline, all the result of the large-scale changes that I describe in The Origins of the Urban Crisis, came at the worst possible moment, when the city became poorer and blacker, and as its infrastructure began to age and deteriorate. Demands on city services increased. Schools had to deal with growing numbers of children coming from disadvantaged households, and at the same time, out-of-date, deteriorating buildings. Sewer and water lines grew older and burst. Streets were pockmarked with potholes, and the city's police and fire departments dealt with endemic crime and fire. One of the consequences of the war on drugs, beginning in the 1980s, was a dramatic increase in arrests, and, as a result, a steep increase in local spending on law enforcement, criminal justice, and imprisonment. To meet the growing demands for city service amidst a decline in tax revenue, the city needed to fill the gap, and it did so by increasing income and property tax rates, as well as by reducing the city workforce. Detroit introduced an income tax in 1962. Voters authorized tax increases in 1969 and again in 1982. In the 1970s, Mayor Coleman A. Young, the city's first black mayor, oversaw a sharp reduction in the city workforce. And, despite unfounded concerns that he was a spendthrift, balanced the city's budget nearly every year he was in office. In the 1990s, Detroit added taxes from casino gambling to its revenue stream. And in the first decade of the 2000s, the city reduced its workforce by about half. The cuts in municipal employment threatened Detroit's precarious black middle class. While city jobs were seldom lucrative, they were stable, offering good health benefits and modest pensions and medical insurance for retirees. Public employment in Detroit and around the country was a lifeline for black professionals, clerical workers, especially women, and also blue-collar workers. As Detroit deindustrialized, one of the city's few bright lights was the availability of government employment, as well as jobs and institutions that relied heavily on government funding and contracts, such as universities, social service contractors, and hospitals. Just as every old industrial city relied increasingly on meds and eds and government, so too did Detroit. At the beginning of 2013, about 40,000 workers in Detroit were employed in the public sector. The city's top employers included two hospitals, Wayne State University, city, state, and federal governments, and the Detroit Public Schools. But each of these came under siege as the result of austerity politics. State and federal budget cuts led to a decline in public employment in Detroit and nationwide. The municipal bankruptcy hastened the process. Austerity not only threatened the city's labor market, but it hobbled the provision of public services, even as many of the city's problems worsened. Detroit has long ranked among the most violent places in the United States, and its aging, abandoned properties are prone to accidental fire and arson. Detroit averaged 90,000 fires in 2008, twice the number of New York City, even though the latter is 11 times more populous. But the city reduced the ranks of firefighters and closed firehouses to save money. The police department was understaffed and underfunded. The month that Detroit declared bankruptcy, local newspapers reported that the Detroit Police Department took an average of 58 minutes to respond to emergency calls. Public education also suffered badly. Beginning in the 1990s and escalating because of state and federal legislation, the Detroit public schools began to fund new, experimental charter schools based on the unproven assumption that privately run, but publicly funded education would improve classroom outcomes. And it began to increase class sizes and close schools. Between 2003 and 2013, Detroit shut about 150 public schools, most of them in the period since 2009, when Michigan's governor appointed an unelected manager to take over the school district and institute draconian budget cuts. Ultimately, the causes of Detroit's problems and their solutions are far bigger than the city itself. Since the 1970s, cities have fallen close to the bottom of the list of national policy priorities. After a burst of spending on community development, housing, and social services in the 1960s and early 1970s, federal urban expenditures steadily spiraled downward. President Carter sacrificed an urban policy to his anti-inflation agenda, and President Reagan cut urban spending from 12% to 3% of the federal budget. The first Bush administration's enterprise zone programs, repackaged as empowerment zones under Clinton, did little to create new jobs or reinvigorate impoverished neighborhoods. Detroit's EZ programs did little to improve the city's economy. Even the Obama administration, which ceremoniously created an Office of Urban Affairs a few weeks after the 2009 inauguration, put cities on the back burner. Even if, for a time, Detroit and other city governments and urban school districts benefited from the infusion of stimulus money under the 2009 American Recovery Act, Detroit has also fallen to suburban indifference or outright hostility to cities, their residents, and their problems. Advocates of regional cooperation, like Bruce Katz and Myron Orfield, have made a persuasive case that the fates of cities and suburbs are intertwined, and that metropolitan economic growth depends on improving central city economies and schools. the balkanization of major metropolitan areas has created separate and unequally funded school districts, duplicative services, and bureaucratic inefficiencies. But the obstacles to regionalism are seemingly insuperable in Metro Detroit, where generations of racial hostility have poisoned city-suburban relations. Suburban municipalities have no incentives to share tax revenues with the city. Many view the city as a lost cause. Not surprisingly, Detroit's black majority looks outward with distrust, fearful that regionalism would simply be another mechanism for suburban control. State policy reflects the deeply rooted national hostility toward cities, especially those with large minority populations. Michigan lacked the political will, and Detroit lacked the regional allies to make a case for maintaining state funding for various urban programs. As a result, Detroit's state shared revenue fell by 48% between 1998 and 2012. But at the same time that the state cut funding, leaving the city to rely on its own dwindling resources, it took control of the city and its school district. In 2012, Michigan's Republican Governor Rick Snyder and its GOP-dominated legislature pushed through a new law that allowed the state to appoint powerful emergency managers, EM, to take over the troubled city governments and school districts. In March 2013, Snyder appointed Kevin Orr, a bankruptcy lawyer, as Detroit's EM. The position comes with sweeping powers. The EM is not accountable to the electorate, but has vast powers to restructure city finances, declare bankruptcy, sell municipal assets, change the terms of city workers' and teachers' contracts, and reorganize or eliminate pensions and other benefits. Under the emergency management system, elected mayors, city councils, and school boards are essentially toothless. Outsiders in the suburbs, in the state capital, and in Washington, D.C., have for decades blamed Detroit city government and the Detroit public schools for the city's financial woes. Some of that blame was warranted. In an exhaustive study of city finances since the 1950s, Nathan Bomey and John Gallagher, both reporters with the Detroit Free Press, found that city officials procrastinated when it came to implementing budget cuts. They did not put enough aside to fund the growing burden of city pensions. Detroit at the time of bankruptcy had twice as many city retirees as active city workers, and they sometimes paid bonuses to supplement the small pension payments to city workers. The city also relied on financial advice from Wall Street, a decision that proved to be disastrous. Mayor Kwame Kilpatrick, the charismatic hip-hop mayor who served from 2001 to 2008, was initially heralded by the centrist Democratic Leadership Council as one of a new generation of fiscally conservative, culturally relevant big city leaders. As it turns out, Kilpatrick proved to be one of the most corrupt mayors in American history. He resigned in disgrace in 2008, after having been caught having an affair with his chief of staff, using city police and funds to cover up the mess, and lying about it until the Detroit Free Press discovered hundreds of tawdry text messages between the two lovers. That indiscretion proved to be minor compared to his misappropriation of city funds and manipulation of city contracts to enrich himself, his family, and friends. In 2013, after years of investigation, he was convicted of 24 felonies, including bribery, extortion, racketeering, and rigging city contracts. He was sentenced to 28 years in prison. Kilpatrick will be remembered for his corruption, but the most devastating legacy of his administration was wholly legal. In 2005, Kilpatrick approved the largest municipal pension restructuring in the United States to date. A veritable army of financial professionals from the nation's top investment banks and insurance companies put together a $1.44 billion deal to fund the city's pension obligations using innovative but complex and highly risky derivatives and credit default swaps. Led by the investment bank UBS, the parties to the deal included Citigroup Global Markets Incorporated, Merrill Lynch & Company, Siebert Branford Shank & Company, Loop Capital Markets, and Morgan Stanley, as well as massive insurance firms, including Financial Guarantee Insurance Company and XL Capital Assurance. The Blue Ribbon team that put together the deal included the most influential firms in the American financial services industry, leading actuaries viewed the deal as sound. Top industry lawyers signed off on its legality. In December 2005, the well-respected industry publication Bond Buyer celebrated Kirkpatrick's foresight, naming Detroit's pension restructuring the Midwest Deal of the Year. But just a few years later, the deal, like many of the high-stakes, high-risk credit deals that proliferated in the late 1990s and the 2000s, unraveled. After Detroit's bankruptcy, all of the parties to the deal dodged responsibility for their role in Detroit's fiscal crisis. A key player in the bankruptcy negotiations, speaking anonymously to the Financial Times, tellingly stated, "Yes, it's our money, but no one wants to be that bank, the one that forced a major American city into bankruptcy." Detroit was perhaps the nation's most prominent casualty of the deregulation of financial services and the tax oversight of Wall Street investment practices that began in the 1990s. Unchecked and poorly regulated, the financial services sector rewarded a culture of risk-taking that left debtors bearing the costs when the schemes unraveled. The sum of Detroit's deficit spending, its debt and debt servicing, and its pension and health care obligations totaled somewhere between $18 and $20 billion. Many Detroiters, including the city's beleaguered mayor, called for a federal bailout of the city. After all, the federal government had saved New York City from insolvency with billions in loans in 1975, and even more recently, the Bush and Obama administrations had spent hundreds of billions bailing out major banks, insurance companies, and Chrysler and General Motors. But the political climate had changed dramatically since 1975, when cities like New York were still powerful political actors on the nation stage. By 2013, with staunch Republican opposition to any bailouts and the sequestration of the federal budget, there was no political will whatsoever to provide any substantial aid to the Motor City. As one Obama administration official stated, the chances of a bailout were somewhere between zero and zero. Instead, in September 2013, the Obama administration announced that it would give about $300 million in grants to the city, all from already funded federal programs, to help pay for the demolition of abandoned properties, the upgrading of the city's transit system, and the hiring of more firefighters. The immediate question, to be resolved in court, is who will bear the burden of bankruptcy? Detroit's retired municipal employees will likely see a cut in their pensions and health benefits. In 2013, the average city retiree received about $19,000 per year. The average retired police officer and firefighter, about $31,000 per year. And Detroit's bondholders and their insurers will likely see a significant cut in their returns and reductions in future payments for debt servicing and interest. It is also nearly certain that future Detroit municipal workers will be paid less and lose the pensions and health care benefits that attracted many of them to work for the city in the first place. In the wake of Detroit's fiscal crisis, an even more fundamental set of questions has emerged. What will post-bankruptcy Detroit look like? Will the city continue to hemorrhage population and jobs? Or will it attract new investment? Is Detroit destined for obsolescence? Or will it reinvent itself, and in the process, reinvent urbanism? Will Detroit's transformation come from the top down, from downtown redevelopment, or will it come from grassroots mobilization? Should the city reinvent itself as a haven of creative and artistic production? Will the city's islands of gentrification spread? What will happen to the city's working-class majority? Some planners, reformers, and public officials argue that the first step to Detroit's revitalization is right-sizing the city. Advocates of this approach assert that it is simply impossible to provide services to a shrinking population spread throughout a city that, at its peak, housed nearly 1.3 million more residents. Large sections of Detroit, particularly on the east side, look more rural than urban, with vast tracts of open land surrounding scattered houses. Providing fire and police service, maintaining streets, even keeping streetlights glowing is costly. Detroit's Mayor Dave Bing, who held office between 2009 and 2013, offered some tentative recommendations. Provide better city services to a demonstration area to attract population and create density, while leaving behind other residents in an urban homestead sector. where, in return for giving up services such as streetlights, the homeowner would get lower taxes, in exchange for experimenting with alternative energy, and, where possible, using well water. But such proposals raised major questions. Short of massive public investment, who will compensate Detroiters who have to move from their existing homes to denser neighborhoods? Even given the reality that Detroit properties are, by national standards, very cheap, buying out tens of thousands of property owners would be prohibitively expensive. Demolition is also costly. The city estimated the cost of tearing down a home at $8,500. Those planners who call for shrinking Detroit argue that clearing land and concentrating the population is essential to ration city services effectively in a period of fiscal constraint. The rationing of city services is controversial, but Detroit lurched in that direction in a mostly haphazard way for decades. In the 1970s, for example, Mayor Coleman Young closed many recreation centers as the city lost population. In the 1980s and 1990s, the condition of Detroit's streets deteriorated as the city dealt piecemeal with a declining infrastructure that it could not afford to maintain. It made little sense to deploy scarce resources to repair streets that were little used. And for decades, the city did not replace many burnt-out streetlights as a cost-saving measure. One of the biggest problems that Detroit faces is how to handle its vast tracts of open land. Many properties have fallen into the hands of the city government because of tax delinquency. Others are held by banks and other creditors because of foreclosures, and most of them have little market value. Some visionary architects and planners have argued that Detroit should take advantage of its status as a shrinking city and allocate that empty land for parks, recreation, or agriculture. A team of architects at University of Detroit Mercy, for example, has proposed building an alternative community, Adama, Hebrew for of the earth, on 3,000 acres on the city's east side, where they would restore natural ecosystems in a local watershed and experiment in sustainable and cooperative housing and farming. Detroit's most famous radical, Grace Lee Boggs, who took an ideological journey that began with Trotskyite factionalism, moved through black power, and shifted to neighborhood and anti-violence organizing, inspired a devoted band of utopians who envisioned Detroit as a collective of communal farms, the world's largest wholly self-sustaining city. That vision of Detroit is more than a little far-fetched. But with at least 875 urban farms and community gardens in Detroit today, it is no more unreal than long-dashed dreams of somehow restoring the city's mid-century industrial might. Since the 1950s, influential Detroiters have held hope for the reindustrialization of the city against ever-worsening odds. Civic leaders have argued that because Detroit occupies a strategic location on the U.S.-Canadian border, it can once again rise as a major manufacturing city. Others point to the fact that Detroit's Jefferson North Chrysler plant, which barely survived the auto industry collapse and bailout in 2009, has now become one of the most productive car manufacturing plants in the nation. But with a continued flight of industrial employment to the poorly regulated, low-wage developing countries of Latin America and Asia, such a rebound is exceedingly unlikely, at least in the short run. Even with incentives, and even somehow if Detroit could expand its highly educated, highly skilled workforce, there are simply too many forces pulling capital away from the city in search of low costs. If Detroit is unlikely to rise again as the Motor City, some planners envision its reinvention as a haven for artists, cultural producers, and hipsters. Urbanist Richard Florida, who made his reputation by arguing that the key to urban revitalization is a city's ability to attract and retain a creative class, has been particularly influential in Detroit. The city's boosters point to the revival of the once bleak Midtown neighborhood, the rise of a thriving arts and cultural scene in the city, the gentrification of Corktown and a few blocks of Michigan Avenue near the abandoned Michigan Central Station, and the conversion of long-abandoned downtown skyscrapers into lofts. Most of those new residents are white, however small in number. Detroit's newcomers are both optimistic and messianic. They see Detroit as the Brooklyn of the prairies, or, even more ambitiously, the next Berlin. For struggling artists, Detroit's bargain basement prices are a lure, with single-family houses in 2013 costing just $21,000 on average, and vast studios a tiny fraction of New York rents. The city has become a mecca for Germans who revere the city's innovative techno music scene. Its magnificent abandoned skyscrapers, empty factories, and shuttered schools have attracted photographers from around the world, leading to a new genre called ruins porn by its detractors, but attracting thousands of tourists every year. It is now home to several trendy art galleries, including a cutting-edge modern art museum, MOCAD, the Museum of Contemporary Art Detroit. To much fanfare, Detroit attracted the holy grail of urban revitalization, a Whole Foods grocery store, with its high-end gourmet fare and organic produce. Philanthropies have joined the effort to change the city's demographic and economic profile. The Hudson Weber Foundation launched the 15 by 15 program to attract 15,000 young, talented households to greater downtown Detroit by 2015. Another nonprofit, Challenge Detroit, leveraged support from major employers and launched a fellowship program to recruit about 30 emerging leaders from around the world to Detroit each year. The sense that gentrification, creativity, and youthful talent are the ticket to Detroit's rebirth is one manifestation of what urbanists call the neoliberalization of the city. Namely, the faith that market-based solutions are more rational and efficient than democratic processes. The reliance on the private sector to provide what were once public services, such as education, sanitation, and housing, and the creation of a favorable business climate by weakening of labor power and workplace regulations, as well as reducing taxes to attract capital. In this view, cities are locked in perpetual competition, just like business firms, and need to cut costs and create incentives to promote capital formation and growth. This is an old story in Detroit, one that began with public-private partnerships during the era of urban renewal, using federal funds to demolish blighted neighborhoods, to construct market-rate housing, and to attract new investment. This process accelerated in the 1970s and 1980s, as the city used eminent domain to clear land for redevelopment and tax incentives to attract businesses and retail downtown, like the high-rise Renaissance Center in the 1970s. In 1980, Detroit spent millions to host the Republican National Convention, touted as evidence of the city's rebirth. There is little doubt that Detroit has turned the corner on some of its most obvious problems, gushed the Washington Post that year. Middle-class whites are moving back into the city, and a visitor senses a new vitality downtown. People are coming downtown to eat in restaurants and visit its glistening Renaissance Center. But efforts to remake the downtown as a convention and entertainment zone, usually with substantial public subsidies, did nothing to stem the demographic and economic forces that were devastating the city. During the 1990s and 2000s, Detroit hopped onto another downtown redevelopment bandwagon, subsidizing professional sports. The city and state helped finance new stadiums for the Detroit Tigers and Detroit Lions. And the city, with substantial private support, spent lavishly to beautify the downtown for the 2006 Super Bowl. A few years later, while Detroit was struggling with fiscal solvency, cutting municipal services, and shutting libraries and schools, Michigan Governor Rick Snyder promised substantial state support for a $650 million downtown development project centered on a new Detroit Red Wings arena. But stadiums and arenas are open only for part of the year, limiting their economic benefits. Most sports-related employment is part-time, and subsidies to wealthy team owners are an expensive luxury in a city unable to provide many basic services to its residents. A new arena might stoke the pride of local sports fans, but it is unlikely to turn around the city, and may, given the city's financial straits, make things worse. The nonprofit sector also stepped up its investment in the city. In the late 20th and early 21st centuries, Detroit area foundations provided financing for riverfront recreation areas, at the same time that city funding for public parks was collapsing. Community-based development organizations leveraged nonprofit and for-profit funds to revitalize commercial corridors and to attract investment, particularly in downtown. Business improvement districts began providing extra services, such as landscaping, security, and street cleaning to make the district safer and more attractive. The payoff is clear. New sidewalks, an outdoor cafe, music venue, and a popular wintertime ice rink in then-downtown's once-forlorn campus Marshes Park. Two major firms, CompuWare and Quicken Loans, moved downtown, and their workers patronized a slew of new restaurants, coffeehouses, retro cocktail bars, and other entertainment venues. Major developers, including Quicken Loans CEO Dan Gilbert, purchased downtown properties, with an eye toward attracting much more commercial and residential development to a downtown that is still quite empty. But it will take more than a few thousand hipsters or white urban professionals or avid sports fans to revitalize a sprawling, mostly African-American working-class city of more than 700,000. The bike shops, gussied-up dive bars, and Whole Foods will neither provide many well-paying jobs, nor will they serve most of Detroit's poor and working-class residents. The increase in downtown employment will enhance the city's tax revenue, a crucial ingredient in its post-bankruptcy stabilization. But corporate headquarters do not provide many entry-level jobs, other than poorly paid, dead-end security and maintenance positions. It has become commonplace today to gauge the health or success of a city on its visible gentrification, even if there is little evidence that these islands of prosperity do much to transform the urban economy or benefit the majority of the city's population. It is hard to be optimistic about the revitalization of Detroit from the vantage point of most of the city's neighborhoods, although a number of nonprofits and planning groups have pushed for change. The best funded and most comprehensive is Detroit Future City, a several hundred page report released in late 2012, the product of a partnership between the city and local philanthropies and civic organizations. Over a 2-year period, the nonprofit group that prepared the report held community meetings, conducted interviews with city residents, set up a hotline, and appeared at community markets and neighborhood events to get suggestions. The Detroit Future City Report reflected city planners' emphasis on the need for density and infrastructure development. Still, its emphasis on quality of life issues, including improving housing, creating jobs, and improving city services, suggests a starting point for urban planning from the neighborhoods in, rather than from the downtown out. The Kresge Foundation, one of the region's largest, pledged $150 million to help implement the report's recommendations. For the first stages, the goals seem modest: shoring up neighborhoods that still have some density, demolishing buildings that detract from those neighborhoods, and planning improvements to the city's transportation infrastructure, including a light rail line along Woodward Avenue. The Future City's longer-term goals, job creation, neighborhood sustainability, and community-oriented development, are ambitious. But without a significant increase in state and federal funding, Detroit will not likely see more than a fraction of those goals met. In a period of austerity, getting adequate funds, even with generous philanthropic support, will be an uphill battle. Perhaps Detroit's biggest challenge is public education. Its schools are poorly funded and often unsafe. Experimental charter schools have not, in the aggregate, lived up to their promise of dramatically improving educational outcomes. The reason for their troubles is simple. Detroit, like most major urban centers, has yet to overcome the legacy of decades of segregation. Concentrating disadvantaged students together is a recipe for failure. Schools do not, and in the climate of austerity will likely not have, the resources to lift students from poverty. Compounding the difficulties of public education are punitive zero-tolerance school discipline programs that suspend or expel students, often for minor disciplinary transgressions. In every respect, the city's secondary schools have failed. In 2009, only 38% of Detroit youth graduated high school on time. At the university level, minority enrollments have declined in Michigan since the rollback of affirmative action programs, leaving open admissions community colleges and less competitive state universities to pick up the slack. The best of those institutions in Michigan, like Macomb Community College, north of Detroit, have expanded courses to reflect the region's changing economy. At Macomb, for example, students can prepare for careers in every segment of the healthcare sector, from medical technologies to nursing and pre-medical. Given that healthcare is one of the few growing sectors in the metropolitan area, this is a sensible course. Many institutions, including Macomb, also are training students for work in new green technologies, such as the repair and engineering of electric cars. Improving educational outcomes is crucial for the city's future, but many Detroiters are well past school age and face all sorts of hurdles to achieving economic security. Laid-off city employees often face prolonged joblessness. Single parents with low-paying jobs or no paid work at all have few supports. Since the mid-1990s, the number of Detroiters eligible for welfare payments has plummeted, as it has nationally. The burden of joblessness falls especially hard on those city residents who have been part of the criminal justice system. Many employers conduct detailed background checks, turning away prospective workers with arrest records. Many entry-level jobs are closed to those with felony records. As a result, those with criminal records are often driven back into the underground economy. Detroit's bankruptcy and its current crisis are the result of decades of racial conflict, demographic change, and especially economic collapse. The history of Detroit that I tell in this book is not simply past. Decades of public policy, corporate decision-making, and racial hostility have shaped today's city and have constrained its future. So long as Detroit ranks among the most racially segregated metropolitan areas in the United States, as of 2010, it ranked fourth in the country. So long as its minority population is confined in the most troubled neighborhoods, so long as austerity politics worsen the everyday quality of life in the city, so long as capital and people continue to flow away, and so long as the city and its people lack political influence in the state and national capitals, Detroit will have a nearly impossible climb out of its slump. Mount Airy, Philadelphia, December 2013. Preface to the 2005 edition. A few summers ago, I spent a humid afternoon driving through the neighborhoods where my parents had grown up on Detroit's west side. My tour took me to the intersection of Chalfont and Santa Rosa, an unassuming corner in a quiet neighborhood of working-class homes where my father had spent much of his childhood. My grandparents' house is still standing, but they would not recognize the neighborhood around it. My father and his brother and sisters used to run across the alley to play at their Aunt Margaret's house. Only faint brick and cement traces of that long-ago demolished house remain. The hint of a foundation, pieces of the cement walkway. Aunt Margaret's house exists intact only in yellowing family photographs. Parts of the neighborhood have returned to nature. By midsummer, waist-high grass and weeds obscure the many vacant lots where 20s-era wood-frame bungalows and simple brick and shingle homes like Aunt Margaret's once stood. Just a few blocks away, a little house, very much like my father's, had collapsed into a pile of shingles and splinters. However grim the vista, many longtime homeowners have created little oases amidst the rubble and ruin. Postage stamp-sized, neatly cut lawns, bordered by zinnias and impatiens, stood out amidst the overgrown lots. A group of boys played hoops underneath a backboard nailed to a telephone pole, a small pocket of vitality in what was otherwise a dreary place. The neighborhood around Santa Rosa Drive is, in many ways, a typical blue-collar Detroit neighborhood, a microcosm of the city's 20th century history. In the years following World War II, when my father was a teenager, manufacturing jobs were plentiful in the city. Along Linden Street, just a few blocks from my father's house, was a row of small factories that fabricated parts and supplies for the automobile industry. Livernois and Wyoming Avenues, the major thoroughfares that bounded the neighborhood on the east and west, provided easy access to the big West Side General Motors plants, and further to the south, to the massive Ford River Rouge complex and the myriad steel mills and chemical plants along the Detroit River. A short drive or bus ride to the east led to the archipelago of Dodge and Chrysler plants near Highland Park and Hamtramck. My grandparents' neighborhood was also home to carpenters, ironworkers, cement masons, and other tradesmen. All of them men. Nearly all of them white. Construction was booming in Detroit's peripheral neighborhoods and its nearby suburbs. Only a few miles to the north and west, thousands of new houses were under construction in sprawling suburbs like Oak Park, Southfield, Redford, and Livonia. Developers broke ground on the first suburban shopping centers and office parks, just about the time that my grandfather graduated from high school. By the summer of 2002, Detroit's post-war boom was a distant memory. Most of the little factories along Linden had closed. Even in rush hour, all six lanes of once busy Livernois Avenue were almost empty, allowing me to drive slowly past the bricked-over storefronts and vacant lots in this once-thriving neighborhood business district. Ravaged by industrial decline, racial conflict, and disinvestment, Detroit had lost nearly half of its population since 1950. Most of the factories that had provided many of my grandparents' neighbors with stable jobs and union-negotiated wages and benefits were shuttered or demolished or running with small, rump workforces. Old Dodge, Maine had been torn down. The Westside Fleetwood plant was long closed. And even the gargantuan Ford River Rouge plant now ran with a few thousand workers, a mere fraction of the 90,000 it had employed during World War II. The neighborhood around Chalfont and Santa Rosa had also changed profoundly over the last half of the 20th century. Until 1963, all of the neighborhood's residents had been white. When I visited, the neighborhood's residents were almost all people of color. Detroit's often violent history of racial conflicts over housing had played out with particular force in my grandparents' old neighborhood. In 1949, area residents, including one of my father's older cousins and my grandmother's twin brother, had formed a neighborhood association to stem the movement of the colored into their neighborhood. Their efforts were, for a time, successful. Blacks moved into neighborhoods to the south and east, but the threat of harassment was an effective deterrent to race mixing in the area around Santa Rosa and Chalfont. An intrepid black family moved into Chalfont briefly in 1955, but protests and violence drove them out. As the neighborhood's white population aged, and as many white families trekked to Detroit's booming suburbs, resistance to blacks weakened. After one last burst of anti-black violence, the remaining whites left in droves. By 1970, the surrounding neighborhood residents were overwhelmingly African American. Aunt Margaret, the last family member to move from the neighborhood, befriended some of her new neighbors, but watched with sadness as many of the nearby houses, not built to last the ages, and now mostly half a century old, rapidly deteriorated. Many properties had been converted into rentals. Others suffered the ravages of their residents' poverty. Old houses, especially cheap ones, often required costly repairs. Exacerbating the situation was the persistence of redlining. Banks and mortgage firms were notoriously reluctant to invest in older urban neighborhoods with large minority populations. As Detroit continued to hemorrhage jobs, population, and tax dollars, a process that had begun in the 1950s, city services deteriorated, schools suffered, and neighborhood residents joined in the litany of complaints about inadequate police protection, irregular trash pickup, lack of snow plowing in the winter, and infrequent bus service. Data from the 2000 U.S. Census provide a more complete picture of the economic and demographic transformation of the little slice of Detroit's west side where my father grew up. In 2000, the neighborhood was 99% African American. 12% of area adults were unemployed, and many more had joined the ranks of what economists called disappointed job seekers, who were no longer counted as unemployed because they had given up looking for work. The median income in the census tract around Santa Rosa was $23,848, nearly $20,000 less than the national median household income in 2000. About one quarter of all households in the neighborhood earned less than $10,000 per year. Altogether, 36% of families with children under the age of 18 lived beneath the poverty line. And, as a stark reminder of the chronic health problems that afflict many working class and poor people, 35% of area residents between ages 21 and 64 were disabled. The area around Chalfont and Santa Rosa was by no means one of Detroit's poorest neighborhoods, Many census tracts had poverty rates of 60, 70, even 80%, and many had lower household incomes. If the census were to take place today, after several years of recession, remember that the 2000 census data were gathered amidst the longest economic boom in the last 50 years, the situation would probably be much worse. The fate of my grandparents' neighborhood is grimly familiar to anyone who has spent time in a major American city. Despite more than half a century of civil rights activism and changing racial attitudes, American cities, particularly the old industrial centers of the Northeast and Midwest, remain deeply divided by race. Poverty rates among people of color in major American cities are staggeringly high. Vast tracts of urban land lie pockmarked with boarded-up buildings, abandoned houses, and rubble-strewn lots. At the same time, hundreds of thousands of acres of marshland, meadow, farm, and forest on the periphery of major metropolitan areas get gobbled up each year for vast tracts of new housing, shopping malls, and office parks. City governments struggle with shrinking tax bases and ever-increasing demands on public services, while wealthy suburban municipalities enjoy strong property tax revenues, excellent public services, and superb schools. The causes and remedies of persistent metropolitan inequalities continue to vex policymakers and to generate intense debate among scholars, activists, and the general public. These inequalities, and a host of deeply held misunderstandings about their causes, led me to write The Origins of the Urban Crisis. The book explains the transformation of American cities through a case study of Detroit as the result of a combination of three forces that occurred simultaneously. Any one of them would have had devastating consequences, but the combined effect of all three reshaped American cities in ways that still affect us today. First was the flight of jobs, particularly the relatively well-paying, secure, and mostly unionized industrial jobs that dominated the post-war urban economy. Second was the persistence of workplace discrimination, despite remarkable legal and political gains accomplished by the struggle for black civil rights. The third was intractable racial segregation in housing, segregation that led to the uneven distribution of power and resources in metropolitan areas, leaving some places behind while others thrived. Sociologist Charles Tilly describes resource hoarding as one of the major contributors to historical inequalities, and the story of the American metropolitan areas, like Detroit, is a history of the ways that whites, through the combined advantages of race and residence, were able to hoard political and economic resources, jobs, public services, education, and other goods, to their own advantage, at the expense of the urban poor. Origins uncovered a largely hidden, forgotten history of actions by policymakers, large corporations, small businesses, particularly realtors, and ordinary citizens that created and reinforced racial and class inequalities and perpetuated the political marginalization of African Americans in modern American life. The transformation of Detroit was not the natural, inevitable consequence of market forces at work. At a political moment when Americans have a deep faith in the market, a faith that has strengthened since I wrote Origins, it is difficult for many listeners to understand that racialized inequality is, at core, a political problem. Still widespread is the assumption that blacks and whites live apart solely because of personal choice, not because of the enduring effects of public policies that have encouraged racial segregation. Deeply rooted is the belief that unemployment and poverty are the fault of poor people and their deviant attitudes and behaviors, not the consequence of macroeconomic changes that have gutted urban labor markets. In the year that Origins was first published, Congress passed a Welfare Reform Act that was premised on a fundamentally individualistic understanding of the causes of poverty. The assumptions that shaped the Personal Responsibility and Work Opportunity Reconciliation Act of 1996 were belied by the previous 50 years of the history of racial discrimination, segregation, and job flight that I chronicled. The fate of Detroit and other cities like it, I argued, was not primarily the result of the supposedly pathological behaviors of the poor, the lack of a work ethic among African Americans, or the breakdown of the traditional nuclear family in inner cities. While many historians and other social scientists have continued to chip away at explanations of poverty that give primacy to culture and behavior, influential conservative scholars, backed by well-funded think tanks and foundations, have continued to ignore or downplay the political and economic causes of impoverishment. Instead, they have resuscitated theories about racial differences in culture, values, and even intelligence. Those arguments, however discredited by rigorous scholarly research, continue to appeal to those who believe that the causes and solutions of social problems start and end with poor people themselves. Origins was my effort to challenge the stale thinking about the causes of race and class inequalities in modern America. It was also part of a scholarly project to open up a rich, historical understanding of the racial dynamics, economic changes, and political processes that remade America in the mid-20th century. When Origins was first published, the literature on post-World War II American history was thin. I situated the history of race and the transformation of post-war urban America in the context of dramatically changing racial attitudes and practices, in the emergence of new forms of capital mobility, and the strange career of New Deal liberalism that simultaneously empowered African Americans while perpetuating race-based inequalities in American life. Each of these topics has now generated a large and incredibly rich scholarly literature, some of which builds on Origins, some of which pushes beyond it, and some of which sets forth important new directions for the field. At the core of Origins is a reappraisal of liberalism and a discussion of the rise of grassroots conservatism, challenging the conventional wisdom that the New Deal had unraveled because of the supposed excesses of 1960s liberalism, black power, and identity politics. I argued that grassroots conservatism, particularly around civil rights and racial equality, was deeply rooted in the North. I also argued, building on the cutting-edge work of scholars of American political development, that racial inequalities were a constitutive part of the New Deal's rights revolution. Recent work by political scientists and political sociologists on welfare, fair employment practices, and workplace discrimination policy, affirmative action, and political ideology has provided an even richer, more comprehensive picture of the ways that federal policies reinforced racial inequalities, even at the zenith of liberalism. A slew of local case studies have shown that the patterns of racial politics and policymaking that shaped post-war Detroit were common to metropolitan areas throughout the country. Studies of housing policy and grassroots politics in cities as diverse as Baltimore, Brooklyn, Lancaster, Milwaukee, Chicago, Philadelphia, and St. Louis have demonstrated convincingly that white racial conservatism or indifference hamstrung the struggle for racial equality well before the tumult of the 1960s. Even in multi-ethnic and multi-racial metropolitan areas like Los Angeles and Oakland and the East Bay, black-white divisions remained a persistent element of post-New Deal politics. The post-war urban South, widely treated as exceptional by popular analysts and many historians, also shares much in common with the urban North. The process of southernization of the North, driven by black and white migration to places like Detroit, Pittsburgh, and Chicago, was countered by a northernization of the South, particularly in the 1950s and 1960s, as northern migrants reshaped southern metropolitan politics, and southerners began to embrace the northern rhetoric of de facto racial segregation. Post-war Charlotte and Atlanta have much more in common with post-war Detroit than I ever could have imagined when I wrote Origins. Tying together the history of these diverse places was a shifting but ever-persistent ideology of whiteness. Origins also built on a then-new, now well-established, literature on racial identities. The early 1990s witnessed a burgeoning interest in the cultural construction of whiteness, with scholars taking a racial marker that had largely been taken for granted and probing its creation and permutations. With the exception of Arnold Hirsch's work on Chicago, however, most scholars of whiteness then and now paid little attention to the material origins and political and economic advantages of whiteness. Rather, whiteness scholars, reflecting the influence of literary studies, spent a disproportionate amount of time on cultural phenomena, such as minstrelsy, novels, music, art, even skiing, with relatively little attention paid to political institutions, markets, and public policies that, more than anything else, manufactured and replicated white racial privilege. Origins was an attempt to bridge the cultural and the structural, to start with the important questions asked by whiteness scholars, but to provide a more rigorous account of the mechanisms that perpetuated racial difference in ideology and in experience. Urban inequality, I argued, is the result of the mapping of understandings of racial differences onto the geography of a city, and of the power of categories of racial difference to create racial hierarchies that shaped housing patterns, workplace practices, private investment, and the public policies that reinforce them. Above all, I contended that racial inequalities persist because of the mutually reinforcing processes of ideology and political economy, of identity and self-interest. Origins is also an account of post-war American political economy, of the ways that corporations, aided by state and federal policies, reorganized capital and workplaces. Above all, it argues that the process of capital mobility and urban devastation began amidst the post-World War II economic boom. When I wrote Origins, most popular and scholarly analyses of deindustrialization focused on the 1970s, in particular the oil shocks, the rise of international competition in industries which America had long dominated, and globalization, as corporations roam the globe in search of cheap labor. A spate of recent historical scholarship on the industrial transformation of 20th century America, a subfield that has taken off in recent years, bears out my argument about the crucial role that capital flight and the introduction of labor-saving technologies played in the devastation of urban America well before the 1970s. The process of deindustrialization began as early as the 1920s in cities dominated by the textile industry, intensified in the post-World War II years, and took a new form in the wake of the economic crises of the 1970s. Cities dominated by a single industry, like Detroit, Pittsburgh, and Gary, reeled when their key industries began to close plants and relocate to other regions. But the process of deindustrialization was equally damaging in cities like Philadelphia, Oakland, and Chicago, which had diverse economic bases. The ostensibly new globalization of capital seen in the late 1990s and the early part of the 21st century is part of the same process that I described ravaging mid-20th century Detroit, even if American corporate tax and trade policies have made it easier for companies to ignore national boundaries and for capital to migrate long distances. The flip side of urban deindustrialization, disinvestment, and depopulation was the process of suburbanization. One of the greatest migrations of the 20th century was the movement of whites from central cities to suburbs. From the opening of greenfield factories, to the rise of corporate campuses, to the proliferation of shopping malls, suburbs have attracted a lion's share of post-war private and public sector investment. While Origins does not discuss suburbanization in any detail, a host of new studies have pushed its analysis of race, politics, and economics beyond city limits. Suburbanization exacerbated the impact of boundary drawing and neighborhood defensiveness that shaped the post-war city. In fact, suburban governments often acted as super neighborhood associations, using their governmental powers to enforce zoning laws that relentlessly excluded low and moderate income outsiders, disproportionately people of color. They fiercely resisted intergovernmental cooperation, staunchly defended the age-old principle of local control, and relied on local taxes to fund local public works, social services, and de facto private schools. Even as African Americans began, in increasing numbers, to make their way to the suburbs, they largely remained confined to racially segregated communities. Remembering the history of white hostility and racial violence that shaped the post-war city, many blacks avoided working-class white suburbs. In Detroit, those included Wayne, Westland, East Detroit, and East Point, Warren, and Hazel Park, among others. In wealthier suburbs where upwardly mobile blacks moved, such as Southfield, a middle and upper middle class post-war suburb north of Detroit, whites, especially those with children, steadily moved out, and few new whites moved in. To a great extent in post-war America, geography is destiny. Access to goods and resources, public services, education, and jobs depends upon place of residence. In modern America, where you live determines to a great extent the quality of your schools, your roads, your access to employment, and how much you pay for these benefits in the form of taxes. The best new histories of suburbia have focused on the ways that racial exclusion, politics, and taxation have reinforced the patterns of racial inequality that I describe in Origins. As capital relocated to suburban and exurban places that were overwhelmingly white, cities saw their tax bases depleted by job loss, shrinkage of property tax revenues, and rising social service expenditures. Suburbs and exurbs, by contrast, availed themselves of wealthier taxpayers and the property taxes generated by shopping malls, office campuses, and industrial parks. City governments found themselves burdened with an aging infrastructure, an increasingly impoverished population, and fewer resources than ever to pay for infrastructure repairs, education, or social services. The result was a reallocation of political power and public resources to the increasingly privatized, exclusionary world of white suburbia. Origins examines the ways that Detroit's policymakers and politicians responded to urban change. Equally important was the role of activists and citizens who resisted racial segregation, who challenged runaway jobs, and who fought for the city's dispossessed. I explored the role of Detroit's branch of the NAACP, the largest local chapter in the country in the 1940s, the Urban League, and neighborhood activists like Bernice Avery, who challenged racial inequalities in housing and employment. I also uncovered the history of trade unionists and working-class activists who struggled against workplace discrimination and deindustrialization. But because of my emphasis on racial politics and economics, these grassroots struggles were not the primary focus of Origins. I argued that the history of resistance to oppression must begin with a clear-eyed understanding of power, who wields it, and its impact on ordinary people. That is not to deny the importance of oppositional politics. In many respects, Origins laid the groundwork for the next stage of research. How did urban residents challenge racial inequality? Within the constraints of multiple reinforcing racial and economic inequalities, what worked and what did not? The triumphs and failures of the Northern Black freedom struggle, the central theme in my current research, is the next frontier for post-war urban, labor, social, and political historians. Some of the most exciting work in recent American history focuses on the grassroots activists, Black and white, who struggled against the odds to undermine racial injustice in the North. Northern activists fought workplace discrimination and pushed for inclusion in union leadership. Open housing advocates challenged unequal housing, while Black residents of public housing projects fought valiantly against official neglect. Boycotters and litigators challenged separate and unequal education throughout the North. Advocates of Black self-determination formed cooperative stores and pushed for community-controlled economic development. Civil rights and neighborhood groups rallied against police brutality. Welfare recipients demanded an end to punitive and stigmatizing regulations. And Black political activists, with some white allies, ran for elected office and pushed to redefine urban liberalism in their own terms. To be sure, all of these activists wielded the weapons of the weak. They struggled for rights, justice, and power on a terrain that was shaped by the larger structural forces that I describe. But they also provided an alternative vision for urban change that ultimately influenced public policies, from affirmative action to anti-poverty efforts to educational reform, even if they struggled against the odds in a political climate that grew increasingly hostile to their demands. The summer that I visited my father's childhood neighborhood, I took a tour of downtown Detroit and some surrounding neighborhoods with a friend who is a real booster of the city. Detroit has lagged a little behind some of its Rust Belt counterparts, but in recent years, the Motor City has built glitzy gambling emporia, two new downtown stadiums, a new opera house, and new riverfront parks. Formerly grim inner-city neighborhoods, particularly around Wayne State University and the Detroit Institute of Arts, have witnessed modest gentrification and a profusion of upscale bars, restaurants, and even a quaint bed and breakfast. Several downtown blocks have sprouted art galleries and trendy watering holes. A few of the empty downtown skyscrapers that photographer and critic Camilo José Viraga once suggested be turned into an American Acropolis, where visitors could contemplate the ruins of a once grand civilization, have been converted into artist lofts and luxury apartments. Detroit's avant-garde music scene continues to find creative, adaptive reuses for old factory buildings and warehouses throughout the city. And private developers, usually with public subsidies, have built new housing on Detroit's east side and on riverfront brownfields. In recent years, many Rust Belt cities, including Detroit, have turned to arts and culture, entertainment, and tourism to revitalize their economies. They have spent hundreds of millions of dollars in subsidies and tax abatements for entertainment venues, conference centers, and hotels in an attempt to lure free-spending, out-of-town visitors to their downtowns. Atlantic City rebuilt its sagging boardwalk and built windowless casinos connected to giant parking garages to buffer gamblers from the city's increasingly black, impoverished population. Detroit has placed its bet on gambling. Pittsburgh and Philadelphia will soon open downtown slots parlors, and many other cities have opened riverboat casinos to attract tourists and their dollars. Nearly every Rust Belt city has gussied up its downtown shopping districts, some more successfully than others, to draw suburbanites downtown. Baltimore built a much-celebrated festival marketplace in its Inner Harbor area, though similar efforts have largely failed elsewhere. Cleveland, viciously dubbed the mistake by the lake by urban detractors, put its hope on waterfront attractions like nightclubs and the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Even bleak Camden, New Jersey has lured tourists to its post-industrial waterfront by building a state-of-the-art aquarium and children's park. Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, Cleveland, Baltimore, Chicago, Detroit, and Washington, D.C., among others, provided lavish subsidies for new urban stadiums and sports arenas. Even if, in nearly every case, their costs outweighed their benefits, stadium builders and many fans celebrated the intimacy, postmodern style, and symbolism of their new coliseums. Skeptics of showy downtown redevelopment schemes have promoted community-based economic development as an alternative. Beginning in the 1970s, as the federal government began its long, steady withdrawal from urban spending, small-scale community groups were left with the task of rebuilding their neighborhoods, scrambling for dwindling community economic development block grants, foundation dollars, and charitable contributions. Against sometimes formidable odds, they have constructed new housing, built community centers, and even attracted supermarkets back to neighborhoods that chain stores long ago abandoned. Cities have also joined in public-private partnerships to encourage the redevelopment of middle-class housing in inner-city neighborhoods. Cleveland's Hoff neighborhood, devastated by 1960s riots, now has gated condominium complexes. North Philadelphia has blocks of affordable housing. And the South Bronx, once an international symbol of America's urban woes, has sprung forth with hundreds of new single-family homes. Community developers in Detroit also have some proud accomplishments. A community development corporation spearheaded by the Greater Hartford Baptist Church brought a Kmart to Detroit's west side, and another nonprofit developer attracted a Farmer Jack supermarket and several chain stores to a stretch of Woodward Avenue that had long been devoid of retail. And public-private partnerships have brought affordable and market-rate housing to the area around Detroit's medical center. More so than in my lifetime, Detroiters are bullish about the future of their city, even if they realize that it has a long, long way to go. They are not alone in their optimism. In the last decade, I have spent time in hip neighborhoods along the Milwaukee, Baltimore, and Cleveland waterfronts, in the revived cultural district in Newark's once forlorn downtown, in the beautiful late 19th century neighborhoods of St. Louis and Buffalo, where preservationists and young people are restoring grand old homes, and in the edgy bohemian enclaves of Chicago's West Side. Every city is hoping that the expansion of a diverse, youthful creative class will be its ticket to revival. I've visited innovative community economic development projects in formerly bombed-out neighborhoods in Boston, the Bronx, Brooklyn, Cleveland, and Newark. In my own adopted hometown, Philadelphia, Center City has been flooded with yuppies and empty nesters who are moving into converted lofts and luxury apartments. The neighborhood around the University of Pennsylvania, which had witnessed serious disinvestment and depopulation beginning in the 1950s, now has restored Victorian houses that cost more than their suburban counterparts. New affordable townhomes are springing up in North Philadelphia brownfields. My own neighborhood in Northwest Philadelphia, long a haven of racial diversity, has a livelier business district than it has had in decades. I can now walk from my house to get a hand-pulled microbrew at our once-shabby corner bar, or listen to a Brazilian or Zydeco band play at our local night spot. Nearly every city has a trendy gayborhood, hip artist colonies and loft districts, and funky enclaves where young people sip lattes and buy vintage clothing. Urban places that were once written off as dead are now buzzing with life. Could the urban crisis be over? It is dangerous to let our optimism about urban revitalization obscure the grim realities that still face most urban residents, particularly people of color. Acres of rundown houses, abandoned factories, vacant lots, and shuttered stores stand untended in the shadow of revitalized downtowns and hip urban enclaves. There has been very little trickle-down from downtown revitalization and neighborhood gentrification to the long-term poor, the urban working class, and minorities. An influx of coffee shops, bistros, art galleries, and upscale boutiques have made parts of many cities increasingly appealing for the privileged, but they have not, in any significant way, altered the everyday misery and impoverishment that characterize many urban neighborhoods. Redevelopment projects, those that have attracted the lion's share of tax subsidies and public investment, have left places like Santa Rosa and Chalfont untouched. Neighborhood shopping districts, particularly in African-American sections of cities, are dominated by pawn shops, check cashing agencies, liquor and beer stores, and cheap clothing sellers. Full-service supermarkets are still scarce, and quality clothes, with the exception of sneakers, are hard to find. Little city, state, or federal money goes into fixing up rundown neighborhood shopping districts. And despite some conspicuous successes, often against formidable odds, community development corporations have made only a small dent in the urban economies and housing markets. Local nonprofits have the will, but ultimately not the capacity, to stem the larger processes of capital flight that have devastated the city. As with all urban transformations, the question is, who benefited and who lost? Chalfont and Santa Rosa, and their counterparts throughout urban America, stand largely untouched by reinvestment, gentrification, and urban boom. Downtown festival marketplaces and shopping malls provide amenities largely for suburbanites and tourists. Art galleries, hip bistros, and coffee houses are wonderful refuges from the bland uniformity of suburban shopping malls. For people with means, today's revitalized urban neighborhoods have a lot to offer. New businesses also contribute much-needed revenue to city tax coffers. Over time, perhaps, they will generate even more investment in central cities. For now, however, racial and class inequalities have persisted, even hardened, in most Rust Belt metropolitan areas. Most people of color have remained on the margins of downtown booms, still segregated by race, still facing the consequences of disinvestment and job flight, still suffering from decades of cuts in urban funding and public services. Detroit residents have, by and large, been disappointed in the relatively few new jobs produced by the city's casinos. Making fudge in Baltimore's Inner Harbor, cleaning hotel rooms in Center City, Philadelphia, or selling beer and gourmet sandwiches in Chicago's new Comiskey Park might create a congenial atmosphere for suburban visitors, but seldom offers living wages or job security. The noteworthy exception to the loss of remunerative jobs in central cities, only partially studied by historians, has been the expansion of meds and eds and government employment. In this sector, public spending and urban reinvestment has brought real benefits to many urban residents. Hospitals and universities, buoyed by large-scale federal expenditures and often unionized, proved to be the only reliable source of job growth in northern cities in the wake of deindustrialization. City government employment, often forced open by civil rights activism in a story that still needs to be told, became an increasingly important employment niche for minority workers left behind in the post-industrial economy. Still, meds, eds, and government jobs are particularly vulnerable to state and federal budget cutting. Urban hospitals are jeopardized by the unavailability of health insurance, an influx of impoverished patients, skyrocketing malpractice and equipment costs, and by the gradual suburbanization of healthcare. City governments have been cutting jobs under fiscal pressures. Universities have increasingly outsourced employment, and those that are publicly funded also face serious budget cutbacks. American cities have long reflected the hopes as well as the failures of the society at large. From the mid-20th century to the present, American society has been characterized by a widening gap between rich and poor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.